what immediately comes to mind when you think about Sonic the Hedgehog? For me, it's doing this, and doing this, and going through these, and finding these. I also associate Sonic with visuals like these. But as the series jumped to 3D, things changed. I found myself just as easily associating Sonic with gameplay like this, or this, accompanied by a style like this and a sound like this. Both of these eras were evocative of the series' gameplay and the character himself. As Sonic Team continued to experiment, however, the series took many forms. Some were good, some were... bold. For you, maybe Sonic is defined by this, or this, or even this. The core gameplay and identity of each game would shift so often that the fanbase would become understandably split on what made Sonic great. Was it supposed to be evocative of the Genesis games, the games that made Sonic what it was? Should it feature multiple characters and styles of gameplay, or should they just focus on Sonic? Had the series lost what made it intrinsically unique as a platformer, or did it maintain that uniqueness somehow? On top of that, the series would be continually responsible for noticeable fluctuations in quality, tarnishing the series in the eyes of many, and demonstrating that Sonic's name no longer meant quality. To an outsider, a Sonic game outside of the Genesis era looked like this, or this, or this, and I can't say I blame them. It wasn't always like this, though. Obviously, in the Genesis era, Sonic was a phenomenon. But even when the series first entered 3D, it blew people away, with some even hypothesizing that it could have helped re-establish Sega as a competitive name in the console market. I wanted to assess the evolution of 3D Sonic as a whole. What elements from the Genesis games persisted when the jump was made? What new elements worked and which ones didn't? Why did those new elements linger for so long? Was there anything truly brilliant in the series' dark age? How did Sonic Team refocus? Why did things fall apart time and time again? And what do we have today? So many questions, and none with a straightforward answer. And yet, despite the complicated history, I still keep an eye on Sonic. I'm not nearly as invested in the new stuff, but clearly the attachment I had with the games growing up was strong enough for me to pay attention, even if my trust in Sonic Team has plummeted. Although I want answers to all of those things I mentioned earlier, the one question I want an answer to most is, why do I still care? I mean, elements of what I loved about Sonic to begin with still linger in each new attempt at the formula, but Sonic Team have embarrassed themselves time and time again. And yet, I still care. I still want Sonic to be this shining beacon of brilliance in game design. Is it even possible anymore? Well, that's what I want to find out. I'm Liam Triforce, and in this video, I want to find out what exactly is compelling to me, and countless others, in 3D Sonic. I want to look to the past, figure out what led us to the present, and hopefully, inform the future. But first, hair loss. Gamers, 2 out of 3 men experience hair loss by the time they're 35 years old. Thankfully, the sponsor of this video, Keeps, is here to help. Keeps is a subscription service that offers clinically proven treatments to help men keep their hair. Treatment plans are personalized for each user, affordable at half the cost of a typical pharmacy, and delivered straight to your door so you can combat hair loss from the comfort of your own home. Keeps also has a network of care specialists, and your treatment plan grants you a full year of messaging with your medical advisor if you ever need anything. No matter what you're looking for, Keeps physicians will help you pick the right products and treatments to match the goals you have for your hair. Whether you wish to prevent hair loss, perhaps encourage hair growth, or just strengthen the hair you've got, Keeps has your back. Or head, in this case. Hair loss stops with Keeps. To get 50% off your first order, go to keeps.com/LiamTriforce or click the link in the description. That's keeps.com/LiamTriforce. After finishing work on Sonic and Knuckles, the Japanese and American staff at Sega Technical Institute went their separate ways. The Japanese staff returned home, including Sonic co-creator Yuji Naka, while the American staff remained at STI in Redwood City, California. Sonic had garnered incredible momentum by this point, dominating the early 90s with acclaimed video games and an attitude representative of the era. He was a star, and Sega was not about to let him rest. they wanted a follow-up to Sonic 3 and Knuckles, the next big Sonic game. Although multiple prototypes came about as a result of this, a fully 3D Sonic game was greenlit by Sega, eventually known as Sonic Extreme. Sonic Extreme was going to be a 3D platformer played through a fisheye lens perspective, which would allow players to see more of the level at any given time, as well as creating the illusion that the level rotated around Sonic as he moved. Players could run away from and toward the screen, as well as enter and exit crevices in the levels to find alternate routes and shortcuts. You could also apparently move Sonic a full 360 degrees around certain terrain, and the level would rotate with him. I'll give them this, 3D platformers were essentially non-existent at the time, and their idea for a 3D Sonic game was intriguing. The gameplay we have now, however, sheds light on the difficulties the team had in creating the game. Gone was the effortless sense of control players could achieve over Sonic's speed and platforming in the side-scrolling games. The implementation of a Z-axis and the ability to travel in 8 directions led to high speeds being difficult to implement, let alone control. It was easy to get stuck on geometry and difficult to maintain the sense of speed Sonic was known for. Thus, the level design accommodated this with scripted sequences and slower, more calculated platforming and exploration. And from a glance, it leaves the game feeling more like an experimental spin-off game than a true follow-up to the gameplay of the Genesis classics. While the initial difficulties spelled trouble for the project, these fundamental design questions would be overshadowed by the hell that awaited the team. Difficulty porting the game from Windows to the Saturn, a botched demonstration to executives, a change in engines as the deadline was looming, and an overwhelming period of crunch led to the project's demise. One of the game's lead programmers, Christina Coffin, came down with walking pneumonia, and she was forced to leave the project to avoid serious health complications. Lead designer Chris Sen became so ill that his doctor told him he had 6 months to live, although thankfully he survived. After losing two of the project's key developers, producer Mike Wallace had no choice but to kill Sonic Extreme, with Sega instead porting Sonic 3D Blast to the Saturn in its place. The story of Sonic Extreme foreshadows things that will become apparent throughout Sonic's 3D career. Rushed development, a misguided sense of direction, and the erosion of trust. The lack of an original Sonic platforming game on the Saturn was definitely a factor in the console's demise. Sonic had a huge effect on sales of the Genesis, and fans were no doubt expecting a Sonic game to headline the Saturn. Instead, what was promoted was eventually cancelled. Within the span of a few years, Sonic went from being one of the most revered and recognizable faces in the industry to a dormant hedgehog in hibernation with a troubled transition to the Saturn. Sega betrayed the trust of many fans and developers, as well as those that bought a Saturn to begin with before Sega openly abandoned it and admitted defeat. It would take a lot to build that trust back up. But what about Sonic Team? Alongside Sonic Extreme at E3 1996 was a much more complete build of Sonic Team's own original game, Nights into Dreams. Although it was less prominently featured at E3, it went on to receive near-unanimous acclaim when it was released a few months later, becoming the flagship game for the Saturn. Nights into Dreams is still an incredibly fun game today, and I believe it informed the future of the Sonic series and how it would be designed from then on. If you've never played Nights, I'll attempt to explain its gameplay as best I can. Seriously, this game is not easy to pick up and play. You control Nights on a 2D plane, and fly up, down, and all around through rings, collecting orbs, and doing tricks, all while running laps around 4 different sections of a level. As soon as you collect enough of these orbs, you'll want to deposit them as fast as possible. The faster you deposit them, the more bonus time you'll be awarded. From here, you can spend as much time as you like running laps and exploring the current section of the level. By going through rings and collecting various things, you can rack up a sizable combo, but you'll have to move fast and be clever with the spiral dash and the paraloop. The higher your combos, the more bonus time you achieve, the better your score. Once you're all finished and before time runs out, you can end the section by re-entering the starting portal, wherein you will receive a rank. Repeat this process 3 more times in 3 distinct portions of the level, and you've completed a stage in Nights into Dreams. You need at least a C rank to unlock the next level, and your 4 ranks are aggregated at the end, so you have some wiggle room. The game encourages you to master controlling Nights at high speeds. The orb collecting portion of each section of a level gives you time to familiarize yourself with the layout, before you try to link actions together as fast as possible for higher scores, which in turn gets you a better rank and sharpens your skills with Nights. Also, the inherent nature of this makes levels super fun to replay, especially when they're designed well. Does any of this sound familiar to you? That's because these ideas were a huge part of the gameplay loop of the first and second Sonic Adventure games, especially Sonic Adventure 2. Replaying levels for higher ranks, performing action chains that reward you with higher scores, mastering Sonic's controls and the layout of a level, it all began here. Nights into Dreams was the blueprint for Sonic Team's first three-dimensional takes on the Blue Blur, which in turn informed the rest of the series as we know it today. As work was underway on Sonic Team's next game, Burning Rangers, the up-and-coming Takashi Iizuka was pushing for the team to create a Sonic RPG with an increased focus on storytelling. Although the RPG concept was never used, his ambitions would later shape the structure of Sonic Adventure. Due to Sonic's lack of presence on the Saturn, it was felt as though the character was already a thing of the past, a sentiment echoed by Sonic Adventure art director Kazuyuki Hoshino. It was time to assess what made Sonic great, bring those essential elements into 3D, and reintroduce him to a new generation. The primary cast of Sonic characters would be redesigned by Yuji Uokawa. He took inspiration from graffiti and comic book art, and redesigned Sonic to have longer limbs and quills. This allowed for players to see his entire body more clearly in a 3D space, and it allowed him to strike dynamic poses more freely than he could in the sprite-based games. This updated look reinvented Sonic's cool and rebellious edge he always seemed to have in an elegant way, and it was used in some of my favorite artwork for the Blue Blur to date. The iconic illustration that was used for the game's box art features a pose that only Sonic could pull off, although the internet certainly tried to prove otherwise. And I believe it speaks volumes to how well Uokawa was able to redefine Sonic. He appeared to be spinning into a ball just as he would in the Genesis games, but thanks to his lanky limbs and the graffiti-like free-flowing line work of Uokawa, he immediately hooked the attention of millions, daring you to play his game. To me, and I'm sure many others, it remains one of the coolest pieces of Sonic artwork ever created. There's an all-new vibe to the soundtrack as well. Jun Sonoe was tasked with reinventing Sonic's sound to match the visual overhaul Sonic and his friends received. He and the sound team primarily settled on rock and roll, a little bit of ska, some funk influences, and simply put, it works. It really works. Much like the new looks for the characters, it's loud, it's in your face, it's catchy, and it's remarkably dynamic despite the narrow focus. Jun Sonoe decided that this would be the new sound to define Sonic the Hedgehog, and it would be predominantly featured in several Sonic games to come. For a more in-depth look at most of the series' music, you can watch my video on that very subject. Honestly, if I were to talk about what each soundtrack lends to the games in this video, it'd never end. In Sonic Adventure's case, it was evocative of the dramatic shift in style to accompany Sonic's first foray into 3D, and his introduction to a new generation. The visuals and sound were a major component in regards to this game's identity, but what about the gameplay? Similar to STI's attempts with Extreme, Sonic Team had to figure out how Sonic would play in 3D with very little to draw from. They went through a lot of trial and error in order to construct a single level in Sonic Adventure, with some levels being rebuilt numerous times. Thankfully, there was a precedent. Super Mario 64. Although Sonic Adventure remains distinct due to its linear structure, certain mechanics and functionality in Mario definitely served as inspiration. The virtual camera system, for example, was something that Mario 64 pioneered. The angle would dynamically change as Mario would scale the mountain in Mabomb Battlefield, or slide down Cool Cool Mountain. It was paramount that the camera makes the action easy to follow in Sonic Adventure because Sonic moves much, much faster than Mario. In Emerald Coast alone, there are multiple dynamic angles so that you can always have a clear view of Sonic himself. And they also made sure that the transitions and panning were as smooth as possible to avoid motion sickness. In Windy Valley, once you're out of the tornado, the camera moves around when appropriate to give each level element its own focus, and sometimes it'll pull in close to heighten the sense of speed. There are probably dozens of dynamic angles in just Sonic's story alone. Like Super Mario 64, it isn't always perfect. In fact, I think the camera in Sonic Adventure is even more egregious sometimes, especially in cramped areas like this section in Lost World. Often you might find yourself fighting against the dynamic angles the game automatically sets up because you're trying to take a shortcut, or get a better view of the world around you. And then sometimes it just bugs out or gets stuck on things. It's not a perfect system, but with that said, for an early 3D platformer taking after Super Mario 64, this is an impressive attempt, especially when you consider the speed of gameplay. Just as Super Mario Bros. Informed the original Sonic the Hedgehog, it was crucial that Super Mario 64 informed Sonic Adventure. And that doesn't just refer to the camera. Camera options weren't enough. the game needed a way for players to reorient themselves when traveling at high speeds. To address this, Sonic Adventure introduces possibly the smartest option they could have given him in a 3D space. The homing attack. If Sonic is curled up into a ball after jumping, and you press A next to an enemy, spring, item capsule, or another targetable level element, Sonic will home in on it. As you probably know, this move has become a staple of every 3D Sonic game since, because it's awesome. For a 3D game that moves this fast, this was one of the smartest design choices this game could have made. You can use it to refocus when you're traveling too fast or making tricky jumps, you can use it to extend your jump distance if you're not targeting anything, you can aim at specific enemies, you can perform well-timed and well-positioned homing attack chains to reach new parts of a level. It was an essential addition to Sonic's moveset, and it complements every aspect of his design. Even at high speeds, and despite the room for error that a Z-axis naturally allows for, I still think Sonic controls beautifully in this game. His top speed is exhilarating, and while it is a bit sensitive to steer Sonic at a breakneck pace, it is nowhere near impossible to control. Sonic's jump isn't floaty or imprecise, and your mid-air control feels just right for precise platforming. His jump distance is relative to his speed, which means your abilities in platforming are directly affected by how well you can master Sonic's movement. You can even use the spin dash and roll into a ball to gain speed on slopes like you could in the 2D games. It's pretty much a direct translation of the way Sonic controlled in 2D. Also, the spin dash is mapped to a button this time around. You can charge it if you like, but you can also spam it to go ridiculously fast. You'll have much less control over Sonic like this, but it does reward you for memorizing routes through each level. The very thing that makes Super Mario 64 such a compelling sandbox for players to mess around in is how fun it is to move Mario around and connect moves together to collect stars. Sonic Adventure shares this philosophy, and despite the game going for a more linear level-by-level structure akin to the classic games, it still has its own way of delivering on that notion. The level design can both challenge and reward your understanding of how Sonic plays, just like the Genesis games. Although Sonic Adventure doesn't center its core gameplay around multiple moves and chaining them together like Super Mario 64, it does utilize the few moves it has when focusing on using speed to explore levels. The levels in Sonic Adventure are almost always well constructed and varied, and they kind of have to be. There aren't any special stages this time around, as the Chaos Emeralds are plot important. As such, the levels in Sonic Adventure are these energetic, ever-changing playgrounds that are just as fun to blitz through as they are to explore for alternate routes. The Z-axis only increased the potential for open-ended level design, and although there aren't any secret rings to jump into, you can find plenty of rings, extra lives, and faster ways to reach the goal. The game eases you in with Emerald Coast, which is a pretty straightforward run through a beach with some cool set pieces, and it has its fair share of shortcuts if you figure out how to use slopes to your advantage, and if you perform a jump out of a spin dash right here. That's right, one of the coolest things you could perform in the Genesis games, the move that helped me to defeat the Death Egg robot, has a huge focus in Sonic Adventure, and I'll show you some examples of it as we go. Emerald Coast is followed by Windy Valley, which introduces homing attack chains and has you running on gusts of wind before you get sucked into a tornado. Here you have to carefully platform your way up to the top on the floating debris, and once you're out, you can run through this fast-paced playground in the sky. Because the level is primarily open-ended and vertical, I'm constantly finding new ways to skip entire chunks of it by jumping off of platforms at specific angles. Even still, just rolling down slopes and crossing platforms in this level is a treat. In Ice Cap, you can take your time carefully platforming through each section, or you can explore a bit for a shortcut at the beginning, assess your surroundings, and perform some well-timed spin dash jumps to skip massive chunks of the level. It is then followed by one of the most iconic sequences in the game. Sonic has to snowboard down a mountain to escape an avalanche, and because the first sequence moves at a steady pace to get players accustomed to the controls, the music actually manages to synchronize with each drop. From here, you'll be smashing through icicles collecting rings, and by timing your jumps and maintaining a good amount of speed on ramps, you can absolutely zoom through the rest of the level. Seriously, it is electrifying when you pull these jumps off. As demonstrated by the snowboarding sequence, Sonic Adventure likes to throw you curveballs to keep things fresh. Casinopolis is structured completely differently from any other level, but I don't think that's a bad thing. You can play some relatively fun pinball minigames to earn rings quickly, and it even has a charming tribute to Knights, but if you don't earn many rings and lose the minigame, you can drop down into the sewer and grab a whole bunch of them. The trade-off is that you have to hang onto them in tight corridors with multiple hazards awaiting you. Twinkle Park begins with this high-speed go-kart race through Twinkle Circuit, and while letting go of the accelerator to make turns does take some getting used to, I enjoy smashing through enemies and collecting rings here. From here, you're dropped into a roller coaster that gives you an overview of the entire level. The platforming is a bit trickier here, but once you've mastered the layout of the level, you'll realize that as you climb, you're just circling around the castle. If you manage to figure out how to use nearby slopes to shoot yourself up on top of the castle, you can skip pretty much the entire level in a heartbeat. Mastering each level is a process, and this is reflected in the B and A rank missions you can complete in the game's trial mode. Sonic's B rank missions ask you to have 50 rings when you destroy the capsule, which means you'll need to know how to rack up and maintain high ring counts whenever possible. This gets players exploring for rings, and learning more about how a level is designed. By the time you reach the A rank mission, you're asked to beat the level within a certain period of time. At this point, if you want to nab those A ranks, you have to know how to bend the rules. I'll jump out of a spin dash to skip certain platforming sections that I don't need to run through, I'll find ways to climb slopes I never thought possible, and I'll even find routes that I've never seen before, much like Sonic 2 or Sonic 3 and Knuckles. The game accounts for players attempting to do this, and it makes for some of the game's best moments. Speed Highway is easily my favorite level in the game for its sense of, well, speed, and how much freedom you have to navigate the level in your own way. You can stick to the main path and roll down slopes to barrel through the level, or you can jump off this first slope with a well-timed jump to grab a pair of speed shoes. And hey, why not take things further? You see those buildings in the distance? They're not just for decoration. They have extra lives on top of them, and you can run up the surface of the building to grab them. You can attempt to maintain your speed on this wall here for a shortcut, but if you fall down, that's okay. There's another path below that can help you catch up. You can chain speed shoes together and time your jumps to keep your speed going, and hit dash panels to correct yourself until you finally reach this part of the level that has you running down the side of a building, dodging hazards and collecting rings until you smash through the glass, walking out into the sunrise. There are multiple ways to reach the goal from here, both on rooftops and the streets below, and it's fun to experiment and find secrets. Speed Highway is an unpredictable roller coaster that is a delight to rush through, and it is emblematic of the balance that Sonic Adventure strikes in its design. Sonic Adventure's design is the perfect balance between spectacle, genuine challenge, and replayability. No matter how you decide to play the game will continue to reward you for playing well and thinking outside of the box. And although it may not have the richness of Super Mario 64's mechanics, the game didn't necessarily need them, as it succeeds in delivering on the simplicity, challenge, and mastery that made me fall in love with Sonic's gameplay to begin with. Not every level is perfect, of course. I may enjoy finding skips in Skydeck, but the center of gravity constantly shifting makes for some sluggish gameplay at times, and the bugs are, well, they are bugs, that's for sure. Alright, I think it's time I talk about one of the biggest caveats to Sonic's 3D design. Not the bugs, although those do have an effect. Certain iconic design elements from the 2D games, notably loops and complex landforms that play with speed in creative ways, must have been too difficult for the developers to implement in 3D. As such, the game will lock players into scripted sequences for certain events. Every single loop in this game is completely scripted. The only thing the player is required to do is hold forward. Now, I am well aware that the Genesis Sonic games could have their fair share of automation, sequences where you just roll into a ball and let the game take you wherever it wanted. But whereas you could jump out of those parts and explore your surroundings for secrets, Sonic Adventure's automated sequences are usually mandatory, and if you attempt to jump out of them, you will either have nowhere else to go, or you'll get caught in a nightmare sequence that ends up killing you. In certain contexts, these sequences are intentional breaks from the action, like the roller coaster in Twinkle Park, or the famous killer whale chase in Emerald Coast. In those contexts, they work. And while these scripted sequences don't impact the overall experience much, except when they break on you, they are indicative of a much larger issue with 3D Sonic that will become clearer as this video goes on. I think it's fair to say that Sonic Adventure isn't a perfect game. In between acts, you'll be exploring the adventure fields, fighting bosses, and occasionally playing minigames. Because Chaos Emeralds are plot-driven, I'm sure the team implemented all of this to keep things from getting repetitive. The results are not always consistent. Very rarely are boss fights any good in this game. The 2D games often had some rather pitiful bosses, but in Sonic Adventure, there's barely any worth noting, aside from the final boss. A lot of these bosses revolve around you waiting for an opening to present itself. At the very least, the Egg Viper is a tense fight that requires sharp reflexes, and you are once again waiting for an opening. The only difference is that actually landing hits can often be its own challenge. There are some decent bosses here, but most of them are rather throwaway. Do I even have to mention the character battles? Of course not. Let's move on. As for the minigames, we have Sky Chase, Sand Hill, and Twinkle Circuit. Sky Chase is a neat little homage to Panzer Dragoon, but it is so poorly designed that you can beat Act 1 and get to the boss of Act 2 by just moving the tornado into the top right corner of the screen. You will not die if you do this. Sand Hill is a brief sandboarding sequence inspired by the developers seeing sandboarders while in Peru. Twinkle Circuit is basically just a time trial mode for the go-kart in Twinkle Park. While none of these minigames are absolute winners, it becomes easier to appreciate what they have to offer if you decide to collect all of the emblems. Remember those B and A rank missions I discussed with Sonic? They reward you with extra emblems. Collecting all 130 emblems can be key to mastering and fully appreciating every facet of Sonic Adventure. As we've discussed, it can make replaying Sonic's levels even more exciting, so let's talk about what they bring to the rest of the experience. First of all, Sky Chase's A ranks are some of the most challenging A ranks in the game, but also some of the most fun. You have to learn how to chain high combos together with your reticle, master when enemies will spawn, and make sure your shots don't fizzle out as you attempt to lock on. Sand Hill's A ranks shed light on the sensitive controls when steering the boards at high speeds, but chaining together these gates to get a higher score, and finding a route that works for you, is a lot of fun. Twinkle Circuit's sharp turns and qualifying times made mastering the simple controls more fun than they would have been had I just played Twinkle Park once and left it at that. You can also find emblems by exploring the adventure fields, which I find to be a compelling aspect of this game that wasn't properly fleshed out. In between levels, you'll find yourself wandering through these hub worlds as you figure out what to do next. Usually, you'll have to take the train or find an upgrade like the Lightspeed Dash, but some upgrades are completely optional like the Crystal Ring, which allows you to charge up the Lightspeed Dash much faster. Also hidden around each adventure field are various emblems for you to collect by applying your knowledge of a character's abilities. Both the emblems and upgrades feel like surreal remnants of a game we never got to play. A 3D Sonic game that completely revamped the structure of Sonic to compete directly with Super Mario 64. A Sonic game that allows you to freely explore your surroundings and collect emblems in order to unlock new things. Some of my fondest memories in Sonic Adventure revolve around me just running around and exploring these adventure fields. I'd always wanted a full game like this. I think the fact that I was able to have so much fun doing all of this is perfectly representative of just how much fun it is to control Sonic and his friends. I could spin dash up hills and dash through the trees of the Mystic Ruins all day. Which reminds me, Sonic isn't the only playable character in Sonic Adventure. In fact, he's one of six playable characters. In addition to Sonic, you can also play as Tails, Knuckles, Amy, and newcomers Big the Cat and E-102 Gamma. They all visit the same stages, with the exception of Amy, Big, and Gamma, who visit the original stage Hot Shelter, but there are distinct differences in the routes you take and the structure of the level, just like a Knuckles playthrough of Sonic 3 and Knuckles. Let's talk about what these characters bring to the table, and whether or not their A ranks flesh out their gameplay. Tails' levels have you racing your opponent to the finish line. As you'd expect, his campaign feels like an easy mode. With the exception of Ice Cap, you'll be flying over the levels you've already mastered with Sonic, and the game encourages you to use his gift of flight to break levels in half. He can roll into a ball to gain speed on slopes just like Sonic, which is just as thrilling, and his endless tailspin attack is quite useful when clearing out enemies and hitting item boxes as you go. For the most part though, you're gonna be flying through rings and breaking the levels. His B ranks do encourage you to look for rings in the levels instead of skipping them entirely, while his A ranks have more vicious, rubber band heavy AI. Overall, it's a nice change of pace, and for what it's worth, being able to skip massive chunks of a level made Sky Deck really enjoyable. I also enjoyed how they handled his story. I always liked the dialogue and voice acting differences in comparison to Sonic's campaign, reflecting his over-reliance on Sonic and his lack of confidence in himself. Honestly, certain moments in Tails' story still make me reflect on how my younger brother viewed me when we were kids. I already loved Tails as he was, but this campaign made him one of my favorite Sonic characters. It's a simple story, told quite effectively. Knuckles' gameplay has him finding three pieces of the Master Emerald in each level. Single sections of each level are elegantly repurposed to feel like compact adventure fields. Okay, maybe Sky Deck isn't very elegant with the awkward manipulation of the ship's trajectory, but the rest are a lot of fun. I suppose with Tails being able to find alternate routes and skips in levels with pacing like Sonic's, rendered Knuckles a bit redundant, so they had him do this instead. You can track each emerald piece at once with the radar on the bottom, and the radar has multiple levels of awareness to help you get a better idea of where the emerald pieces might spawn. Although each emerald spawns in a random location upon loading into the level, there are a finite amount of locations that they can spawn in. and the hints can often guide you in the right direction. This gameplay style emulates the slower, more exploration-heavy gameplay of Knuckles in his debut game. It repurposes familiar level sections with new set pieces and a unique focus, rewarding memorization and skilled navigation. But it is significantly more enjoyable when you begin to memorize the Emerald locations and go for the A ranks. In B rank missions, you have to find the Emerald pieces without using hints, which essentially forces you to rely on your radar and knowledge from your initial playthrough of the game. Then the A ranks have you find them within a very short time period, usually 1 minute. This is the ultimate mark of mastery. If you know where the Emerald pieces can spawn, you should be able to forge a path to them without running out of time. You can restart from the last Emerald piece you collected, but since you lose a life every time you restart, your limited life counter in trial mode can make this more challenging. This is where I really began to appreciate both the clever design and construction of Knuckles' gameplay, as well as the helpful radar system and the compact size of these levels in general. It felt like a fair challenge, even if Emerald RNG can stretch you a little too thin at times. I had a lot of fun with Knuckles' A-rank emblems. Amy, however, is not very fun to play as in any capacity. Her gameplay is much slower, feeling more like a traditional 3D platformer, except much clunkier with some mediocre platforming challenges and elementary problem solving. Her A-ranks can challenge you to master her fastest movement, but she just makes me wish I was playing a Mario game instead. And then there's Big the Cat. I mean, I could say what everyone else has already said. His gameplay doesn't belong, it's difficult to understand what you're doing wrong when Froggy stops biting, Big could be removed from the story and it would have next to no impact. But then I remembered the A-ranks. Holy crap, the A-ranks. I could go where few gamers had ever gone. I could actually explore Big's mechanics in depth. So I got every single one of Big's emblems. Here's what I learned. First of all, the fishing controls are actually explained in-game if you check out Big's instructions. You cast, you wait, and you immediately hold down on the analog stick when you see a bite. Then you just alternate between the fast and slow reeling buttons to avoid filling the tension meter and breaking your line, and voila, you've caught Froggy. Yes, it is as simple as that if you want to beat his campaign, and you can beat it lightning fast if you know what you're doing. Sometimes you might have to find the damn frog by solving a puzzle, but for the most part, that's all you need to do. Of course, if you don't know what you're doing, it's hell. But I am a real gamer, and I know how to play as Big the Cat. Froggy is child's play, a cakewalk compared to the kinds of fish you have to catch for the A ranks. For each A rank, you'll need to catch a 2-kilogram fish. Your total haul cannot add up to 2 kilos. No, you need to specifically catch a fish of that weight or above. Sometimes they will only spawn in specific areas, sometimes you'll have to do something specific to find them, and sometimes they'll only spawn when they feel like it, as is the case with Twinkle Park. Also, sometimes big fish will be just shy of the size you need, even though it is virtually indistinguishable from a 2-kilogram fish. Sometimes you'll be trying to reel in large fish, the fish will refuse to cooperate, and you'll be sitting there trying to reel in a fish for potentially minutes at a time. No matter how hard you fight against its attempts to escape with the analog stick, its movements are so hard to predict that you will be forced into a war of attrition. Imagine doing that, only to accidentally break your line, or the game reveals you were a few grams short the whole time because they thought it'd be funny to prank you. That stupid slide guitar music became maddening within minutes of me being in Emerald Coast. Every time I hear it, I get post-traumatic flashbacks. If you're going to attempt these A ranks for whatever reason, get the lure upgrades. You will need to find all 4 in the adventure field in order to even have a chance at catching large fish. Yes, this means you have to slowly waddle through each adventure field as Big the Cat, looking for them. Basically, Big the Cat is a sick joke that the developers are playing on us. And the weird part is, Big's fishing mechanics are actually pretty good for what they are. It's just that Big's A ranks have confusing variables, frustrating random factors, and a boring hunt for upgrades, and Big himself has no right to exist. Now, I've gone on at length about these other characters because they are no longer optional. You have to play through the game as all 6 characters in order to unlock the final battle against Perfect Chaos with Super Sonic. The B and A ranks are optional, but you do have to play through all of their campaigns. Of course, you could play through Sonic Adventure as just Sonic and leave it at that, but you'd be missing out on a large percentage of the game, as well as connecting threads in the story that can sometimes be pretty compelling. As such, my main question is, why? Why have other mandatory playstyles especially ones that contribute next to nothing to a Sonic game, instead of focusing on fleshing out one. Yes, they can be pretty fun, and I do get some enjoyment out of Tails and Knuckles at the very least, and while they are short, their campaigns combined end up drowning out your time with Sonic. On top of that, Sonic is still far and away the best character to play as, the others don't compare. I suppose games were getting bigger in scope and they wanted to make sure people felt they were getting their money's worth, but why Amy? Why big? Hell, some would argue that treasure hunting doesn't really belong either. Well, the A ranks I've talked about bring significant depth to pretty much every playstyle, and introduce elements of speed, memorization, and experimentation that made the Genesis games so fun. They dramatically increased my enjoyment with Knuckles, made Tails even more enjoyable to play around with, and even encouraged players to get better with Amy. What do you get for collecting every emblem in this game? In the original Dreamcast version, you get nothing. Nothing other than personal fulfillment and bragging rights. In Sonic Adventure DX, you can at least unlock full Game Gear games and an alternate Metal Sonic skin for Sonic, but with an experience this uneven, it's hard for me to recommend others do the same. But hey, Super Mario 64 didn't really reward you with anything other than a chat with Yoshi, and I always have a blast grabbing 120 stars. At the very least, did I enjoy myself collecting all of those emblems? Absolutely. It contributed so much to my enjoyment of the game as a whole. But it is entirely contingent on whether or not you even enjoy any characters other than Sonic. This leaves most people with the basic objective of completing each level with every character once, which is an inconsistent journey that takes the focus away from the game's true accomplishment, beautifully transitioning Sonic the Hedgehog's gameplay into 3D. The game stumbles over its own ambitions, and it results in a game that I don't think has aged very well. The numerous bugs and glitches don't really help either. The game was rushed to meet a deadline of Christmas 1998, and future re-releases would actually introduce more bugs into the game. But they'd learn their lesson, right? With all of that said, we have one campaign left to talk about. A lot of this game's story will pause to introduce bits and pieces of the overarching narrative to each character. It's a story about understanding the world you live in, as well as the emotions of others. You have an awesome final battle with Perfect Chaos that focuses on how well you can maintain your speed, and after you blast through him a few times, the game ends on a satisfying note. The story doesn't take itself too seriously, and I appreciate that. It may have repetitive cutscenes that you see multiple times throughout each playthrough, recycled boss fights for each playthrough that get tedious very quickly, extremely questionable, albeit iconic, voice acting, and an overall vibe of cheesiness, but I do enjoy how each character gets a story true to their nature. The game is capable of telling a great story, and Gamma was proof of that. Gamma's gameplay is unorthodox, but I found it to be enjoyable. The timer in Gamma's levels will tick down instead of up, and to avoid getting a time over, you have to increase your timer and make it to the goal. How do you increase the timer? By getting combos with your blaster. The more enemies you lock onto and kill before your targeting system fizzles out, the higher your time bonus. It's a pretty great system that still places a strong focus on high-speed action, and the A ranks further encourage your mastery of this system by having you complete the level with a specific amount of time remaining. Hot Shelter is the strongest example of Gamma's gameplay. The length and enemy placement make it a tough balancing act, especially when going for the A rank. While Gamma's boss fights are just as pitiful as anyone else's, his core gameplay and especially his story make up for it. Beginning life as just another robot in Eggman's E100 series, he is tasked with finding a frog for Eggman. But upon doing so, he is teleported to the ancient Echidna temple. After observing some chow for a bit, T'Kol tries to stop him, but she realizes he's not inherently evil. Throughout his campaign, he is confronted with problems that make him question his purpose, and strengthen his moral compass, like watching his siblings be cast aside like junk. After being tasked with retrieving a lost bird, Amy is protective and asks him why he needs it, and he isn't able to comprehend why Amy would want to help that which is useless to her. He acts selflessly upon hearing Amy out, and I love the way Gamma processes all of this afterwards. The egg carrier crashes, and as he's flying into the mystic ruins, images of those he encountered up to that point flash in front of him, until he eventually realizes he must save his brethren from Eggman's aimless command. And so, that's what you do. At the end of each level, you mash the fire button on the other E100 series robots until they die. Maybe they can achieve some form of peace in destruction. Gamma's story concludes with him facing off against Beta Mark II aboard the floating remains of the egg carrier in a boss fight that is actually fairly decent. But it's what comes after that I remember most. Just as Beta is about to explode, he gets in one last shot on Gamma, fatally injuring him. Beta dies, and a bird flies out of him, as Eggman is known to use woodland creatures for his creations. Gamma, as he is about to die, realizes that the bird he saw was part of a family. Although I didn't immediately realize the significance of this, I put two and two together as Gamma blew up, and the game was fading to black. The baby bird's other parent was trapped within Gamma, and therefore he had to die in order for them to reunite. Perhaps Beta realized this as well, and killed Gamma so that the family could be together again. Gamma's heroics are never recognized, nor does Eggman even uncover his betrayal. In Sonic Adventure 2, he continues to make E-102 models in Gamma's image, which is morbid. But at the very least, Gamma was able to reunite a family in death. What a powerful story. Gamma's story is so tonally distinct from the rest of the game. It doesn't rely on hammy voice acting, cheesy one-liners, or goofy cutscenes, and Gamma himself rarely speaks in comparison to the rest of the cast. And yet, it is by far the most deeply emotional story a Sonic game has ever had. Future Sonic stories would attempt to be taken seriously, but very few of them packed the heart and direction that Gamma's story had. Honestly, it reframed my entire view of this game, and collecting all of those emblems. Even if I am not recognized for my accomplishments with some great reward, I wanted to do those things. Come to think of it, that's pretty much representative of Sonic as a character. That's what his cheesy theme song is all about. It was directly paralleled both in Gamma's story and my experience with the game. Both characters are doing what they feel is right. And you know what I want to do? I want to spin dash jump to skip level sections. I want to break levels in half with Tails. I want to grab all of the emerald pieces in under a minute. It seems silly, but although these A ranks are entirely optional, they contribute so much to the game's design. And I do everything all over again. Despite everything wrong with it, and despite the questionable decisions it made regarding multiple characters, I still think Sonic Adventure is a great game. I cannot in good faith recommend it in its entirety these days, but it still means a lot to me, and I think its high points make it well worth checking out. It gave the Dreamcast a strong launch, and laid the groundwork for all future 3D Sonic games to come. We'll be discussing iterations of this foundation as we go, but if they were to take the underdeveloped emblem hunting and A-rank collecting seriously, trim the unnecessary gameplay elements, and refine the ones that work, a truly amazing sequel would be practically guaranteed. And that's what Sonic Adventure 2 strove to be. I love revisiting Sonic Adventure 2. Its replayability is through the roof, and it hones in on that obsession with A-ranks I fostered in the original game. With that said, I rarely do full playthroughs of it anymore. Much like the first game, playing through it normally and going for all of the emblems provide entirely separate experiences. To begin, we'll start with what emblems bring to the game, because I believe if you play Sonic Adventure 2 this way, it can be one of the most rewarding games in the entire series. In SA2, there are only three gameplay styles. Sonic and Shadow have the fast-paced platforming action that you'd expect, Tails and Eggman have the gameplay of E-102 Gamma, and Knuckles and Rouge have the treasure-hunting gameplay of SA1. Upon completion of each stage, you're given a rank, and these function more closely to Nights Into Dreams in how they are assigned. It's dependent on your score, which is calculated based on how fast you complete the level, how many rings you have when you touch the goal ring, and the score you've accumulated by simply smashing bad guys and performing tricks. There are also golden gun beetles hidden in each level worth a free 2,000 points if you manage to destroy it before it disappears, rewarding you for thinking outside of the box and exploring. One of the coolest things Sonic Adventure 2 introduces are what the manual refers to as technique points and action links. Essentially, if you chain together a series of actions with Sonic and Shadow, obtain a high combo with Tails or Eggman, or find an emerald piece quickly without any hints, you'll be awarded with some way past cool technique ratings, worth anywhere from 100 to 2,000 points depending on which one you receive. You can also get them based on individual feats, like performing well-timed tricks off of ramps and rails, for example. These ratings make going for A-ranks and mastering each style of gameplay so much more satisfying, as the design of each style is driven by this mechanic. Sonic and Shadow's levels are more linear than SA1 and less driven by finding alternate routes with your techniques, although those routes and shortcuts can still be found with clever use of your abilities. Upgrades, both required and optional, can also be found inside of levels with every character, as there are no hub worlds in this game. It's just focused on level-by-level action, and when it's good, it's really good. The focus on linear design in Sonic and Shadow's case, in particular, just brings more importance to the technique points and moving as fast as you can through each stage when going for A-ranks. It's a different approach than the original game, but certainly not worse. I love chaining homing attacks, light-speed dashes, rail grinding, and bounces together with Sonic and Shadow. It's easily some of the best 3D Sonic gameplay in the entire series. Rail grinding, as a mechanic, isn't taught well in the game, but it has so much nuance to it that can grant you a ton of speed when mastered. The light-speed dash from SA1, which forced you to slow down and charge up before you could use it, can now be used at the press of a button. I mean, it's mapped to the same button as every other action, but it's a massive improvement in regards to the flow of gameplay. In order to get an A rank in each level, you have to master the art of maintaining action links throughout the length of a level. The entire stage just becomes a playground for you to maximize your score, and I can't get enough of it. To complement this fundamentally solid action and to make up for the lack of exploration, the levels are once again these vibrant and exhilarating rushes of brilliance. City Escape is one of the most iconic levels in a Sonic game, and for good reason. You begin by falling out of a military plane and zooming through the streets of San Francisco on a piece of the plane, performing tricks and making tight turns to keep your speed going, as this iconically cheesy rock piece backs you up. Then you blitz through some basic platforming that teaches you a little bit about the core mechanics of Sonic's gameplay, before suddenly you're running on foot down the streets and launching Sonic off of ramps to fly through the level. The entire thing is just this exquisite rush of dopamine when done right. And it all ends with you running from a giant military truck in an anxious fight to hang onto your rings. Metal Harbor introduces the light-speed dash as the jets fly overhead and you make careful jumps, before the end of the level arrives and you have to board the rocket before it takes off. In order to get the A rank, you have to move through the walkways as fast as possible, take the hint at the first spring that there might be more to the level, chain some homing attacks, and just barely make it to the second spring in time. You'll get a point bonus high enough to cross the threshold. Radical Highway is this enthralling series of slopes, tricks, and jumps, and exploring the Golden Gate Bridge to find faster routes makes for a particularly memorable set piece. There's also some top-notch high-speed platforming in White Jungle, the anxious skill-driven grinding and jumping in Skyrail, and Final Rush is this absolutely incredible, often open-ended series of rails, tight platforming, and tricky homing attack chains and light-speed dashes. You are essentially required to explore and find bonus rings and enemies in order to get the A rank. And playing well in this level is an exciting challenge. Not every Sonic and Shadow level is a blast, but overall these stages are some of the best 3D Sonic we've ever received, and they alone are once again why I feel this game left such an impact. Not only are they fun to play through normally, but going for A ranks and mastering the score system and the nuance in each mechanic when it comes to simply going fast is peak Sonic game design to me. Which reminds me, in the stage select, you can choose to go for A-ranks in 4 bonus missions. The first is your average playthrough, the second has you collecting 100 rings as fast as you can, the third has you finding a lost Chao, the fourth has you beating the level in a certain amount of time, and the fifth is a slightly tweaked, redesigned version of the same level. Think Master Quest from Ocarina of Time. Although the 100 rings and lost Chao missions are simply about achieving your goal as fast as possible, the others factor in score for your A-rank, making the hard mode missions some of the most difficult A-ranks to obtain. Each mission will completely transform the way you view the level, with the Lost Chao requiring you to find each character's Mystic Melody ability first. From here you have to listen for a Chao's gibberish, and then find the Mystic Melody platform to reveal hidden platforms to the Chao. I honestly don't want to spoil too many of these locations for you because I genuinely think they reintroduce exploration into Sonic Adventure 2 in some of the coolest ways. Even if you don't get an A-rank when you initially find the Chao, once you know where they are, it's about getting there as fast as possible. In short, I love going for the A ranks with Sonic and Shadow. But what about the other characters? Well, this is where my feelings toward this game get a bit complicated. Like I mentioned, Tails and Eggman's levels are platform-heavy adaptations of Gamma's gameplay from SA1. There is no timer ticking down this time, you rack up high combos for higher action link rewards, and because the levels generally move at a slower pace, achieving those rewards is a lot more manageable. Finding the gold gun beetles requires you to either shoot fast or risk losing it for a combo. All of this makes for some pretty solid A ranks for the most part, and the slower pace also contributes to how fun it can be to locate each lost chow. Now for the stuff I don't like. Tails and Eggman's levels can be dull, clunky button mashers if you choose to play normally, and the design of some of these stages make me not want to ever attempt getting A ranks in them. For one thing, Tails and Eggman have much stiffer controls than Gamma ever did, which makes platforming an absolute chore, especially with how unforgiving it can be when you're going for an A rank. There are so many parts of these levels that can lead to instant death after one small mistake, and for what? What the hell does carefully jumping in a giant mech have to do with the gameplay loop of Sonic the Hedgehog? That's why Gamma punished you based on time instead of raw platforming. This is just clumsy. Oh, by the way, if you die after a certain point in each level, all of the score you accrued is reset back to zero. This makes the mech levels the absolute worst to A rank in the entire game. And don't even get me started on the hard mode and 100 ring missions. The mech characters have health bars because due to the enemy placement and narrow level design, you are expected to lose a lot of rings. And with the jerkish enemy placement in a lot of Tails' stages, where enemies just inexplicably fall from the sky, yeah, I've said enough. On top of all of this, if you just want to beat each campaign and see the narrative through to the end, you really don't have to put effort into learning the combo system at all. While combos can help clear out large groups of enemies at once, you can get away with just shooting wildly at anything that comes your way. The combos don't increase the amount of time you have, like Gamma's levels, and the rankings don't have any bearing on simply reaching the game's ending. Which brings us to the treasure-hunting gameplay of Knuckles and Rouge. Like SA1, the A ranks in Knuckles and Rouge's missions encourage memorization of the level layouts and emerald locations. And this time, they have levels designed specifically for them, with distinct theming and unique gameplay concepts. Maybe you'll have to scour a gun vault for 3 Chaos Emeralds in 5 minutes, or check out the 3 towers in Pumpkin Hill, or take a dive in Aquatic Mine. Knuckles and Rouge are also much less stiff and awkward to attack with than Knuckles in SA1. You no longer stop in place when trying to punch something, and you get a speed boost from it as well. You can also perform a drill dive to clock enemies from above, which is super satisfying to use, and it also helps a ton when you need to head back down in more vertical level design. The missions once again gradually familiarize players with the layout and emerald placements, although getting A ranks can still be contingent on crappy emerald spawns. The 100 Rings and Lost Chow missions get players intimately familiar with the level's many goodies and secrets, the fourth mission has you put your memorization of the emerald locations to the test against the time limit, and while the hard mode makes finding the emeralds a real challenge, they actually spawn in set locations, making the A ranks a breeze on repeat attempts. The nature of Knuckles and Rouge's gameplay makes finding golden gun beetles a lot of fun, and even though using hints can take away from that beautiful point bonus that A ranks are dependent on, there's nothing wrong with using them to memorize emerald locations for later. That's what I appreciate about these levels. Here's what I don't like. In some regards, the treasure hunting gameplay can be fundamentally worse off in comparison to SA1. For starters, the radar sucks now. It only has 3 levels of awareness, and it can only track 1 emerald at a time. You've probably heard this complaint before, but if not, this means you could be right on top of an emerald, but the radar won't let you know because you're supposed to find a different one first. In a complex maze-like level like Death Chamber or Security Hall, or in a massive level like Meteor Herd, this means you could pass an emerald several times without knowing, and waste time trekking through parts of the level you've already visited, just to see if you missed one. You can still grab an emerald out of order if you see it, but the radar won't tell you about it at all. Being able to track multiple emeralds at once helped the game move much faster, which is the very essence of a Sonic game, the element that the foundation of the series was built on. In addition, although I enjoy the notion of levels being designed specifically for these characters, and some levels are pretty fun to master, I don't like exploring all of them enough to go for A ranks. Some level gimmicks are obnoxious to find emeralds in. I've already mentioned the maze ones, and while I enjoy the compact size of Aquatic Mine, the constant adjustment of the water levels don't make it very enjoyable to traverse on repeat attempts for me. Meteor Herd is cool, but it's too big for its own good. And Mad Space's anti-gravity and multiple planets are nauseating and disorienting to explore. Now, you can agree or disagree with my assessment of each gameplay style if you want, and while I think it's important to note that going for A ranks gives significant depth to each style of play, hear me out for a second. Let's say you're just playing Sonic Adventure 2 like you would any other video game. You pick either the hero or dark story, and you realize that you have to alternate between multiple gameplay styles that you might not even like. Tails and Eggman have button-mashy shooting segments with cumbersome platforming, and Knuckles and Rouge have these sprawling, non-linear levels that require you to pick up emeralds one at a time. In the Dark Story, you don't even start out by playing as Shadow the Hedgehog, you start out as Eggman, in a mech. And sometimes the game inexplicably turns into a kart racer with some of the stiffest controls I've ever had to adjust to. In SA1, you could choose to just play Sonic's story and be done with the game if you so desired. But in this game, you have no choice, which can negatively impact a first-time player's experience. I want to reiterate that going for A ranks and collecting emblems is where I get the most enjoyment out of all three of these gameplay styles, and it's where I think Sonic Adventure 2's design shines brightest. You could hypothetically be collecting emblems in Sonic Adventure 2 bit by bit for years, which is exactly what I've done. And that's not even factoring in the Chao Garden, oh my god. I spent hours of my life collecting animals and chaos drives and levels, just to raise my Chao for races. Chao races actually yield a few emblems, so it can be an essential part of the game's replayability. Although SA1 had a Chao Garden as well that you could grind out as you collected all of the other emblems, it does not have nearly as many complicated variables and offers less experimentation in comparison to this game's Chao Garden. It gets repetitive after a short while, but I care so much about these little guys and watching them succeed in races that it doesn't grow as tiresome as it could've. This was a huge part of my childhood. I used to have my friends bring their memory cards over so we could battle our Chao in karate. I still feel strongly about it returning for a future game, and if not, just make a mobile game out of it, Sega, please. Anyway, with all of this meat to the game, I've been able to joyfully revisit it for years. There's so much to discover, and so much to master if you choose to seek it out. But much like SA1, all of that is entirely contingent on you liking these gameplay styles to begin with. And this time, adjusting to the radically different gameplay between each character is forced. If you don't think you'd enjoy the treasure hunting or mech stages in this game, I'm willing to bet you won't really like Sonic Adventure 2, even if the Sonic and Shadow levels are fun. To some, it can be the best 3D Sonic game ever created should they choose to embrace its ranking system, gameplay styles, and emblems. To others, it was a mixed bag that foreshadowed the imminent dark age of Sonic. I am somewhere in the middle. I don't know where I am exactly, but I do know that this game is capable of being amazing. But I also know why it remains divisive. Instead of focusing on nailing down Sonic's gameplay and building other characters from that foundation, they instead tried to include as many characters as possible both to experiment, and later to satiate fans' desires to see them represented. At the very least, the characters' values create great parallels between their respective counterparts, and I enjoy how they come together in the end to avoid the destruction of the planet. The actual narrative is a fun ride in spite of the ridiculous events that transpire. Like Sonic learning how to use Chaos Control from watching Shadow perform it once, and using it very conveniently on a fake emerald that was supposed to be used to destroy the Eclipse Cannon, as well as everyone mistaking Shadow for Sonic despite the fact that they have a video close-up of him. At the very least, tonally it is consistent with the original Sonic Adventure, and I can appreciate that. Eggman's grandfather being executed, notwithstanding. I also love Cannon's Core as a test of everyone's gameplay, and the fight with the Bio Lizard is intense, especially as you have to land the final blow without being able to collect any rings. And the final boss is an amazing piece of spectacle for what it is. Not too easy, not terribly difficult, and the music is, well, it's live and learn. Enough said. It's hard to believe that at one point Shadow was somewhat compelling. There's a reason he remains a fan favorite. Good old Moody Broody was so consumed by vengeance after the military killed someone close to him. Throughout most of the story, he refused to see the good in people. Sonic, however, demonstrates the selflessness that can exist in humanity. Amy pleads for his help, and this, conveniently, allows him to remember what Maria asked of him, because this game is silly, and he sacrifices himself, fulfilling his true promise to Maria. With his death, and all of the characters coming together in a grand finale, it feels like Sonic Adventure 2 was intended to be the last Sonic game. Around this time, the PlayStation 2 had destroyed any market share Sega was hoping to have with the Dreamcast, and they had to pull the plug on console manufacturing. Even if it remains divisive today, if they ended the series here, I would have been satisfied with Sonic Team's output, and Sonic's legacy as an icon of the industry would be forever remembered with fondness. But, as we know, that didn't happen. Sega went multi-platform, and Sonic continued. At this point, Sonic's future was in Takashi Iizuka's hands. Naoto Oshima left the company after Sonic Adventure, and Yuji Naka stepped into a producing role from Sonic Adventure 2 onwards. SA2 was largely Iizuka's work, and it remains his favorite Sonic game he's ever worked on. Rather than creating a direct sequel to Adventure 2, we received the all-new game Sonic Heroes instead, so that new players would not feel alienated. Apparently, development of Sonic Heroes was so stressful that Iizuka lost 22 pounds and suffered from insomnia as he fought to meet the deadline. Okay, surely Sega recognized what they were doing to their developers with this game, right? Right? Although I know reception of this game is mixed, at times, I love Sonic Heroes. But once again, not entirely. I appreciate its renewed focus on the core elements that made Sonic fun on the Genesis, but it also has some glaring issues that serve as a detriment to the whole experience. In structure and in art direction, Sonic Heroes feels especially close to a perfect 3D conversion of a classic Sonic game. It's a stage-by-stage platformer with a boss in between each zone. Also, special stages are finally back. You get to them in a manner that reminds me of carrying 50 rings to the end of a stage in the original Sonic or Sonic CD. You find one of these keys and carry it to the goal ring without taking a hit. If you lose the key, there's always a chance to find another one if you look hard enough. It's so rewarding to carry my high ring count to the end of the level, and it, of course, contributes to the rank you receive at the end. In Act 1, you'll access a bonus stage that is only good for extra lives, but in Act 2, you'll have a chance at the Chaos Emerald. These special stages, unfortunately, aren't very good. The control is very sensitive and finicky, especially if you travel at high speeds. It does kind of mitigate the impact of special stages returning. Also, Super Sonic is yet again a final boss gimmick. You cannot use him in normal levels. It doesn't seem like it'd be difficult to implement, just disable the ability to receive a ranking or an emblem if you're playing a Super Sonic, right? So that you don't break the game in half? Oh well. Sonic Heroes is also beautifully evocative of the Genesis games in art direction, and they emulate those games without cheaply imitating or ripping off previous levels. Of course, the checkerboard patterns in Green Hills may be cliché now, but the attractive design of the ocean palaces, the vibrant and numerous colors on display in Grand Metropolis, and the casino levels always struck a chord with me, and those are just a few examples. In general, Sonic Heroes' levels have some fantastic elements, and they focus on being engaging no matter how you decide to play the game. If you're going for special stages, A-ranks, or just trying to get to the end, there's a lot of challenge and creativity on offer. From the rush of speeding through Grand Metropolis and Power Plant, to the bounciness and danger in the casino levels, especially Bingo Highway and its bingo minigame as you slide down the board. Then there's the death-defying rail grinding of Rail Canyon and Bullet Station, the whimsical rush through the ever-changing flora and fauna of Frog Forest and Lost Jungle, the various tricks and puzzles that await you in Hang Castle and Mystic Mansion, and finally the sense of scale and danger as you traverse the dizzying heights and limitless alternate paths of Egg Fleet and Final Fortress. I love pretty much all of these levels, but there are a few things that can make them annoying to play. Sonic Heroes revolves around the team mechanic. Despite the game having 12 playable characters, there's only one gameplay style between all of them. In each team, you control speed, flight, and power characters, and you can switch between these three types at any time. Each character has their own specific uses, and when you're moving this fast, it can be satisfying to apply them in a series of high-speed puzzles. As you level each character up from 1 to 3, they can accomplish more. For example, Knuckles' default punching combo can end in a giant explosion, Sonic can kill most enemies on his own with a single homing attack, and it becomes so powerful that it can take the place of his tornado attack. Tails' Thunder Shoot breaks the game in half as soon as he hits level 2, which makes him my preferred character for taking out flying enemies and groups of egg pawns. Even with enemies sporting health bars, for the most part, intelligent use of your abilities and strategic use of the screen-nuking Team Blast can help you clear them out as fast as possible. This is what makes Sonic Heroes' core gameplay so satisfying to me. It puts a unique spin on the high-speed gameplay I've come to enjoy by introducing problem-solving that moves just as fast. When it works, it comes close to being my favorite 3D Sonic game. But that's the thing. It isn't always the best it can be. Although I love most of the level concepts, there is some repetition of certain design elements that bog down the whole experience. Certain areas of each level are repeated throughout to simulate depth, and when the game asks you to repeatedly slow to a crawl to defeat enemies, the game starts to drag, especially during the last few levels. Apparently, only two people at Sonic Team were designing levels, Iizuka himself and one other person. Considering only two people were responsible for the levels, this is impressive. But you can see the inevitable cracks in their work from time to time. When it comes to combat, the boss fights are pitiful once again. Mash the A button or spam Thundershoot, take your pick. I especially hate being locked in with a seemingly endless assortment of bad guys, because it exposes the holes in the rock-paper-scissors combat of Sonic Heroes. A lot of the game hinges on it, and circumstances like this just exacerbate the issues people have with this system. On top of all of that, the controls in Sonic Heroes are ridiculously sensitive and slippery. They move like they're wearing shoes made of butter at high speeds, and your top speed is blisteringly fast in this game. So as you can imagine, this can make for a deadly combination. I mean, you can get used to them, but I still fall to my death as a result of the imprecise controls of Sonic Heroes. I can understand that going multi-platform meant they had to switch to a new engine, but I'm surprised by how much of the groundwork they cast aside. Sonic Adventure's controls were part of the reason the game was so much fun to play and experiment with. Why do away with them? You can't even spin dash in this game. You have to perform a rocket accel, which is finicky at best and unreliable at worst. With that said, nothing compares to the awful structural flaws that Sonic Heroes contains. You might be wondering what the heck I'm even talking about because I mentioned the game moves from stage to stage like the Genesis games. Well, it does. But here's the caveat. You can play as four teams. Team Sonic, Team Dark, Team Rose, and Team Chaotix. They all have their slight gameplay differences, but you can think of them as the difficulty select of this game, kind of like Sonic 3 and Knuckles. Team Dark goes through more of any given stage and they encounter more enemies, Team Rose goes through less of a stage and encounters less enemies, and Team Chaotix is one of the worst things ever. But because they go through the same stages, certainly you can treat it like a difficulty select and you won't have to play through every single team to unlock a last story segment, right? Surely they've learned from Sonic Adventure, right?
Oh no!
Playing the game like this just makes the issues I've mentioned even more apparent. And because the game mandates Team Chaotix, I'll explain why they're awful. In each level, you have to go out of your way to find a specific amount of things, or kill a specific amount of enemies. If you miss one, you have to take the teleporter at the end of the level and start all over again. This meticulous design goes against the flow of both Sonic Heroes and a Sonic game altogether, and destroys the pacing of the game entirely. If they were attempting to structure the game like the adventure games, all they really did was ruin what would have otherwise be a decent attempt at replayability. I mean, why not make these teams optional? You beat the game once, come back to it later, and try another team. And on that note, why even have A ranks and emblems anymore? Not only are you playing the game four times over to reach the ending, but you also have to play each level again with slightly different win conditions. So in total, that's 8 playthroughs of the same game for true 100%. I like Sonic Heroes' gameplay, but not that much. This is just shameless padding. I admire a lot of Sonic Heroes' concepts, but the game feels botched. I can at least recommend you try out a single playthrough of the game, and I'd recommend that you stay the hell away from Team Chaotix, but I shouldn't be recommending portions of a game, or that you play the game in a specific way to maximize enjoyment. I should be able to recommend all of it. All 3D Sonic games up to this point have had this issue. I shouldn't have to be selective about which parts I am compelled to experience. This series makes me feel insane for enjoying it. In any case, Sonic Heroes was certainly a distinct take on the Sonic formula, but its central mechanic was merely a gimmick that wouldn't exactly inform the future of the series, despite the fun you can have with it. So now the question was, what next? Well, alright then. Although Sonic Heroes' story is simple for the most part, you might have noticed that Shadow is inexplicably alive after his plummet to Earth in SA2. He suffers from amnesia, and either the other characters never feel the need to tell him about his past, or Shadow feels he needs to discover it for himself. Whatever the reason, we received a full game exploring Shadow's mysterious origins. Except not really, because it's a choose-your-own-adventure. Hero or Dark, you decide. Depending on your choices, plot points can be dropped completely, while others appear with no explanation. I suppose they wanted players to piece it together through the various routes, but that just makes understanding whatever truth the story is trying to convey even more convoluted, not to mention utterly ridiculous. The hilarious part? The last story cancels out the entire concept of the game, essentially being the only canon ending. Even if that weren't the case, the story goes all over the place depending on your choices. You can take the true hero path up until the very end, and then switch to Black Doom's side just to screw Sonic over. Plot points with the Gun Commander, Maria, and Eggman will be dropped completely if your route diverges. You can disobey Black Doom altogether, and yet he'll still follow you around as if nothing happened. It's an incoherent, awful mess of disjointed plot lines and laughable storytelling. Although it does have this line.
This is like taking candy from a baby, which is fine by me.
You can consider Shadow the Hedgehog the game that jumped the shark. Characters are cursing in an attempt to make the game edgier. Shadow is shooting people. There are aliens. The visuals are a grim mix of dark colors. This game is hardcore, isn't it? Well, when you look past its rough exterior and cringeworthy presentation, you'll find one of the most inexcusably boring and repetitive Sonic games ever conceived. The entire game's structure revolves around Team Chaotix's collectathon gameplay. This means killing a certain amount of enemies, activating a certain amount of MacGuffins, and teleporting around the level to see if you missed a single enemy. Some missions just require you to get to the goal ring, but these are rare. Usually you're exhaustively checking every corner of the level and slowly tapping the analog stick so that you don't miss anything. When just running through to the end of the stage and shooting everything in sight, the core gameplay is passable, and I do get a kick out of the infinite ammo during Chaos Blast, but it's a mindless, miserable excuse for a 3D Sonic game. And in order to reach the last story segment, you have to fight all 10 bosses on the level chart. You have to play this game 10 times over. Shadow the Hedgehog contributes virtually nothing to the Sonic formula or the discussion of 3D Sonic in general. It innovates on little. A-ranks are essentially a worthless endeavor as the game is already repetitive enough, and it's a complete waste of Shadow as a character. This game clouded my perception of him, and to this day I question why I loved Shadow as a kid, because all I can think of when I imagine him now is Edgy the Hedgy with a gun and a motorcycle. Though, things couldn't get any worse, right? I'll skip the dramatics. This game is bad, but conceptually it strove to be the best attempt at what we've come to understand as the 3D Sonic formula. There are genuinely great ideas beneath this game's rough exterior. Were they executed well? Not really, but I'll give credit where credit is due. In Sonic 06 there are three campaigns, Sonic, Shadow, and Silver. Although Silver's gameplay is an outlier for reasons I'll discuss, basing the majority of each campaign's primary characters around Sonic's gameplay was a smart move. It's what the Sega Genesis games did, and they seem to have something going here with Sonic and Shadow having their differences. In addition, the multiple playable characters are strewn about each campaign to break up the pace of gameplay, rather than having full levels or unnecessary campaigns devoted to them. This is much appreciated, but are the characters fun? Throughout Sonic's campaign, you play as Sonic, Tails, and Knuckles, with a brief and jarring cameo appearance from Silver. Despite Sonic's top speed being severely nerfed, Sonic's controls are still even more sensitive than Sonic Heroes, and Sonic himself doesn't feel nearly as satisfying to play as. It seems like a single tap of the analog stick can send Sonic running off to another planet. It has this artificial sense of fluidity, whereas the Dreamcast and GameCube games gave actual momentum and weight to Sonic when you attempted to steer his jumps and top speeds. He would slow down on inclines and speed up when moving downhill. Here, not only does Sonic seemingly run at the same speed no matter what the terrain looks like, he'll also magnetize to virtually any walkable surface. Case in point, the snowboarding sequence in White Acropolis. You can actually move uphill at the same speed you would accrue moving downhill, as if Sonic is riding a jet-powered snowboard. On top of this, the game is designed to automate a lot of things. Homing attack chains, loops, dash panels, rails, so many moments in this game's level design play themselves, as long as you know how to hold forward and press the A button wherever necessary. Wave Ocean has multiple egregious examples of this. Remember the whale in Sonic Adventure? Imagine scripted sequences like that, but repeated several times over with very little input from the player. Granted, this isn't the norm for level design, and I'll talk about the positives soon. I just need to vent first. Levels also like to focus on combat in the same vein as Sonic Heroes or Shadow the Hedgehog, which sheds light on just how much slower and monotonous the homing attack is in this game. Rather than being able to quickly go from target to target, they implemented this delay between attacks that grinds the pace of combat to a halt. You're better off just spamming the bounce bracelet when you're on foot. Some of Sonic's abilities have unnecessary restrictions placed on them. Ever since the original Sonic Adventure, we've been able to witness the degradation of the spin dash. It went from being one of the most powerful tools in Sonic's kit, to having a somersault as a secondary option, to a finicky rocket excel move, to barely having a focus at all, and now in Sonic 06, you can only perform it while standing still, and you can't jump out of it. One of the most liberating tricks you could perform in the adventure games is now non-existent. The game relies heavily on scripting, combat, and specific design elements to generate thrills, rather than player ingenuity. A problem that began with Sonic Adventure noticeably seeped into this game, and it would continue to plague the design of later games. Sonic also has alternate playstyles of his own. The sections where he's carrying Princess Elise restrict your movement to just the homing attack and a shield. And despite some cool set pieces, the levels are just less interesting to me because of Sonic's limited moveset. The snowboarding segments are... oh dear god, what do they do to these? We've already talked about how artificially it moves, but let's talk about controls. You can only use about 180 degrees of the analog stick to steer the snowboard. If you so much as tiptoe outside of that radius, Sonic will immediately stop moving. Trying to adjust his trajectory from there is torture. I gave the controller to my brother at one point and asked him to try playing, and the results were accurate to my first playthrough. The last of Sonic's alternate playstyles are his mock speed sections. Because Sonic can no longer run fast, they decided to give Sonic sections where he moves at the speed of sound without being able to stop. If you hit anything, Sonic will spin around in midair whilst continuing to move, unable to allow the player any time to reorient themselves. If you jump, you cannot control Sonic in midair. If you decide to jump, you have to know what lies ahead. You have to commit to your landing, otherwise you'll be unable to save yourself from a mistake. I don't dislike the notion of not being able to stop running. It invites a new kind of danger to the fast-paced platforming, and I believe it served as a precursor to Sonic's next style of gameplay. It's just that it gives the player little control, little time to acclimate, and little room for error, transforming the potential for genuine challenge into unnecessary frustration. As for the other characters, Tails is slower than Sonic and his flight controls are nowhere near as satisfying as Sonic Adventure. He doesn't attack with his tails, instead throwing dummy ring bombs at enemies. It's an awkward attack, and if you get hit for some reason, you'll have to scramble to find which of the rings on the ground are actually real. Tails sucks. Knuckles and Rouge have you exploring your surroundings like the Sonic Adventure games before you can proceed as Sonic or Shadow. Knuckles' punches don't register half of the time, Rouge's attack has her pausing to throw bombs like Tails, and both of them are much slower than they should be. They suck. Shadow, unfortunately, is even more combat-centric, forcing you to mash the A button to kill enemies in a combo over and over again, but you can use his meter to throw Chaos Spears and even perform a dinky version of Chaos Blast if you want to clear out groups of enemies. This is fine, but the heavy focus on combat slows the game to a crawl, and his vehicles don't add anything of worth to the game as a whole. Shadow kinda sucks. Amy sucks because her platforming and combat are painfully slow and boring, even more so than Sonic Adventure. Omega sucks for the same reasons, although it is fun to break levels in half with him. Silver, sadly, was a huge disappointment. The concept of physics-based telekinesis was something that fascinated me, as I loved playing with the gravity gun in Half-Life 2. Sadly, most of his stages are these slow, basic platforming sections, with the same combat loop of freezing missiles in midair and throwing nearby boxes at enemies. There was this section in Kingdom Valley where you have to throw a box at a faraway platform so that you can cross, which made me wonder about what might have been. What if they had some clever physics puzzles akin to Half-Life 2 that involved Silver's telekinesis? If his campaign had more substance, I feel like it would have been a nice change of pace, even if he was vastly different from the other Hedgehogs. As it stands though, it is easily the worst of the three campaigns. Silver, unfortunately, sucks. Blaze is pretty fun though, because she can double jump and quickly dash between enemies, and she has this fire spin that can clear out enemies in a heartbeat, but her sections are so short that they barely leave an impact. So, there are 9 playable characters, and few of them are often any good. But I think the methods in which they were implemented were an improvement over the adventure games. Not in overall quality, but structurally, it makes sense to intersperse new characters throughout each campaign to break up the pace. It makes me wonder how this game could have gone over if it wasn't riddled with questionable design choices. There are certain levels in this game that shed light on what might have been. I enjoy chaining together light-speed dashes and homing attacks to find shortcuts in Kingdom Valley. I enjoy the challenge of moving fast through Crisis City and Flame Core, and there are once again alternate routes aplenty. There are some genuine flashes of brilliance in this game's level design, and Chaos X's Project 06 helped me to notice them. Project 06 is one of the greatest video game remakes I think I've ever played, because it took something seemingly unsalvageable and made it a remarkably enjoyable 3D Sonic experience. Sonic has far superior controls, and you can dash between targets with his homing attack in the blink of an eye. You can now jump out of a spin dash to find those hidden routes and shortcuts I touched upon. Tails can actually attack with his tails, and his ring bombs have a targeting reticle. Knuckles can actually hit things, and Rouge can attack like she did in Adventure 2. The snowboard actually has decent controls. Granted, there's only so much Chaos X could do about the inherently scripted level design and certain things that make 06 what it is, but the game is actually fun now, and it made the surprisingly open-ended level design of Sonic 06 much easier to discover and appreciate. And then there's the mock speed sections. Oh my god, these are amazing now! Not only does Sonic have much better control while running and lightspeed dashing along trails of rings, but you can also control him while jumping! This single change transforms the way you can experience these sections, potentially using Sonic's powerful high-speed jumps to skip certain portions of the level. And since you can now jump into and bounce off of enemies, which was a feature absent from the base game by the way, I've been able to do some fancy things with Sonic at high speeds. As of this video, the Silver campaign isn't out yet, but you can play as him in specific sections, and his mid-air dash and general handling make him far more enjoyable to play, and a decent rival to Sonic and Shadow. Not nearly as fast or exciting, but that's not really the point of his campaign anyway. There's also not much you can do about his levels, but it'll be fun to see what kind of stunts you can pull with his revised moveset. Shadow, however, received such an incredible overhaul to his kit that he actually rivals Sonic in terms of quality, which is something that I think the adventure games should have always strived to achieve if they were to implement multiple campaigns and playstyles. And because Chaos X implemented the proper action link system from Sonic Adventure 2, you can be rewarded with some staggering technique point bonuses. This can make going for the highest ranks at the end of each level some of the most engaging 3D Sonic gameplay in the series. Technique points do exist in the original version of Sonic 06, but they are only triggered when you nuke a certain number of enemies at once, or you jump through a rainbow ring. In Project 06, nailing down combos with each character adds a significant layer of depth to each character's gameplay, as well as the hunt for S ranks that was missing from Sonic 06 originally. Higher ranks in Sonic 06, at the very least, gave you rings so that you could purchase upgrades, both optional and required. It's a smart way to give the rankings purpose beyond replayability and personal satisfaction. But because nearly all of the upgrades in Sonic 06 are optional, and the fact that the game forces you to do missions around its hub worlds and earn rings anyway, you'll have all of the rings you need fairly quickly. In that case, I'd prefer if they hid the upgrades around the hub worlds because these places are devoid of any design personality or life. This is where my biggest issues with Sonic 06 truly lie, the awful structure. Because Sonic's moveset is so limiting, the hub worlds are not fun to explore. The missions are some of the most rudimentary tasks you could imagine, the bosses are uninteresting and repetitive waiting games, and the game loves to insert 15-second loading screens between every single scene transition. I guess the last thing we should mention before I move on are the upgrades you obtain for Sonic. These colorful gems all give him unique abilities like a grappling beam, a quick burst of speed, etc. As you use them, the meter slowly depletes, but you can replenish it by defeating enemies. Wait, it's not depleting. I checked the instruction manual, it shows the meter depleting. Does this mean I can... Oh my. If you weren't aware, the retail build of Sonic 06 doesn't have a properly functioning meter for Sonic, which means you can use the gems to your heart's desire. Leap tall buildings in a heartbeat. Run as fast as, well, Sonic the Hedgehog. Don't want to play Silver's portion of Kingdom Valley? Well then don't! Just jump over it entirely. Look, two Sonics. Okay, I think I'm done. There's not much else I really need to say about Sonic 06. In an attempt to instill a sense of direction back into the Sonic series, their ideas were deeply misguided. This game is overstuffed with poorly thought out gameplay, characters that aren't fun to play, cool level design that doesn't get to properly shine, a structure that pales in comparison to its predecessors and slows the game down to a halt, an abundance of technical faults, and some of the worst writing I've ever witnessed. This game wanted to accomplish so much and instead delivered on next to nothing. The most unfortunate thing about this game is that you can feel ambition in it, and you can feel the potential for greatness, especially having played Project 06. Sonic Team wanted to refocus, and there are some great ideas in place here, but its adherence to the elements and structure established with Sonic Adventure, and a desire to please everyone by including multiple playable characters, led to the team stretching themselves too thin. Sonic 06 left deep scars on Sonic's legacy, destroyed any faith people had in Sonic Team to deliver on experiences, and the series needed a complete reset if it was going to recover. After the failure of the previous game, Sonic Team chose to completely reinvent 3D Sonic. Sonic would be the only playable character, and they would come up with an entirely new gameplay style, seeing as their continued attempts to build upon the adventure formula crashed and burned for numerous reasons. Sonic Unleashed would be the fruit of their labor. It showed promise, but I didn't think it was the game to resurrect the series. They tried their absolute hardest to make this game compelling, but it didn't go over as well as I think they hoped it would. Ever since this game came out, I've so desperately wanted to like it, but I dislike the vast majority of its ideas. With that said, when it's good, it's really damn good. In the daytime levels, you can build up your boost meter by collecting rings and smashing bad guys. When you boost, Sonic will constantly move in a manner similar to the previous Mach speed sections, but with far more player control. While running this fast, the levels have to both match the player's instincts and challenge their desire to keep up this pace, and it does this in a commendable fashion. It combines several game mechanics, multiple design elements from previous games, as well as new design elements to create some of the coolest 3D Sonic levels in the entire series. Take a look at this section in Arid Sands. You can simply boost through these enemies and take dash panels through to the next part of the level, or you can jump over them, lightspeed dash along a trail of rings, stomp down onto the rail below and boost through, jump off and then position and time your next stomp so that you can land on the next rail and continue to skip this first chunk of the level. Perhaps the most rewarding part about the level design in Sonic Unleashed is how it gets significantly more difficult in later levels, while still offering a sense of euphoria when the level is mastered. Skyscraper Scamper has these sections where you have to make split-second decisions in order to survive, and the trails of rings and level design can guide you as you master the layout. Although it unfortunately has little relevance to an average playthrough once more, going for all of the S ranks in the daytime levels has provided me with some of the most fun I've ever had with Sonic the Hedgehog. You have to make careful platforming decisions in the blink of an eye, hang on to massive amounts of rings, and destroy enemies and take advantage of level elements to maximize your score. It is so liberating to not only travel at speeds this fast, but also to maintain that speed by playing well throughout the length of each level. It's a balance that is difficult to strike in a game like Sonic, but man does it go over well here. These levels are so much fun to play that I feel compelled to revisit them over and over again, just for the heck of it, which is a feeling that made the Genesis games and certain parts of the adventure games so legendary. Coupled with the rich level theming and killer soundtrack evocative of the environments you explore, it's clear to me that this game could have truly been something special. It's no wonder it has a cult following these days. My problems with Sonic Unleashed stem from everything else it has to offer. I know the Werehog is generally seen as the hog that killed the game, but there's a reason people view it in that light. The Werehog levels do have some cool set pieces at times to their credit. I love platforming my way up the clock tower in Spagonia, only to reach the top and see just how high up I am before crossing the hands of the clock to the goal ring. I don't like much else about the Werehog levels from here though, and they make up the majority of the game's runtime by far. The combat is serviceable at best and you do unlock a decent pool of moves, but it pales in comparison to the rewarding and player-driven experimental combo systems of games like Bayonetta and Devil May Cry. The enemies themselves don't offer much variety. Aside from the mini-bosses, they are mere fodder for you to smack around. They lock you in areas and force you to fight enemies before you can proceed, and the Werehog's platforming controls are imprecise and not quite as tight as they could have been, leading to some annoying deaths when platforming for medals. The Werehog's gameplay is so far removed from the very foundation that Sonic was built upon, but even disregarding that, it doesn't hold a candle to its action-packed inspirations. The game's structure and pacing are easily my least favorite elements about it. The game forces you to scour for Sun and Moon medals in order to unlock the next levels. In daytime stages, they can be placed organically along hidden routes, but other times you have to kill the pace of your run to find them. In nighttime levels, they're abundant, but also require you to check every nook and cranny of a level. Hub worlds once again return, but they're nothing special as they rarely take advantage of Sonic's moves in creative ways, and you'll often have to look for someone to talk to in order to find your next objective. I love the atmosphere of these hub worlds, but in practice, they're not very fun to explore. If you could obtain medals based on the rank you receive like the Wii version of the game, and unlock new levels that way, it would actually encourage players to get better at the game. It's a shame that I don't enjoy Sonic Unleashed because I love it conceptually. Its message about dark and light existing as two sides of the same coin may have been handled far better in other stories, but it is both a powerful way to encapsulate the game itself, and it was reflective of the state of the series at that point in time. Although Chip had to fulfill his purpose as Light Gaia, he was still able to experience the sights and sounds of the world with Sonic. And what a world it was. Sonic Unleashed can be just as frustrating as it is gripping. And for some, those fleeting moments of joy were enough to make the adventure worthwhile. but the notion that Sonic had to fall to darkness before it could see the light once again is something that I think the developers grappled with in developing Sonic Unleashed, and you can feel their desire to rise to the top once again in this game's best moments. 2 years after Sonic Unleashed, we received Sonic Colors for the Wii. At the time, it gave fans hope for the future of Sonic and was seen as a return to form, essentially taking the boost-heavy gameplay of the daytime levels of Sonic Unleashed and turning it into a full game. That is heavily simplifying it, but that was what it felt like at the time. In truth, it plays it extremely safe, and it results in one of the more consistent and accessible 3D Sonic games, for better or worse. Apparently, the game was designed with fans of more traditional platformers like Mario in mind, and it shows. While you can still boost, drift, and sidestep your way through certain portions of levels, these segments are far more linear and broken up into acts so that they don't alienate non-Sonic fans. While this isn't much of an issue in the context of Sonic Colors' design, automation can creep in at times, an element that plagued previous 3D Sonic games. Starlight Carnival is heavily guilty of it, as much of a visual treat as it is. The first 50 seconds of Act 1 basically play the game for you, with the exception of a couple of sequences that require some basic inputs from the player. There are moments like this littered all throughout the game. The game has its moments where it rewards fast reflexes and mastery over Sonic's high speeds, but it also balances this with slower, more careful platforming sections. Sonic even has a double jump to compensate. The platforming is often fairly basic, and it can even get monotonous, but the focus on speed and platforming, as well as occasionally dividing these things up for variety's sake, makes it a Sonic game that I can recommend to anyone. The wisps allow you to more intimately familiarize yourself with levels, especially the drill wisp, but they're usually implemented to give you a quick rush of dopamine, like laser and especially frenzy. Problem solving with creative use of the wisps isn't a huge focus. That is, unless you decide to go for the red rings. Remember how I mentioned medals were placed throughout the daytime levels of Unleashed? Basically, there are 5 red rings in each level, and they're placed in far more organic places that encourage exploration and use of the wisps in clever ways. By collecting all of them and unlocking the 7 Chaos Emeralds in the minigame world, you can actually play as Super Sonic in the regular stages like the Genesis games. Finally. With that said, the game very heavily resorts to two-dimensional segments, and I see them as a cop-out due to the difficulty of designing more fleshed-out 3D stages. Whereas Sonic Unleashed implemented 2D sections sparingly as a change of pace, Sonic Colors relies on them to the point where I hesitate to call it a 3D Sonic game. It's more like a 2D Sonic game with 3D elements. Okay, that may be a bit much, but there's a lot of 2D in Sonic Colors. I also don't think the more traditional approach to platforming and exploration will impress every longtime fan of Sonic, but Sonic Colors' consistent focus on creating a fun video game was enough to inspire hope for the series' future games. The music and visual design of each level seems to reflect this as well. This magnificent assault of beautiful sights and sounds, accompanying a new era for Sonic the Hedgehog. I still enjoy Sonic Colors for what it is. Sonic Generations was another Sonic game that may have played things safe, but it still managed to be one of the best entries in the entire series. It was also a fantastic celebration of Sonic's history, with memorable surprises that left me excited to see what was around the corner with each level. Levels were once again these seamless balances of lightning-fast speeds and clever, fast-paced platforming, and there was a wide assortment of alternate routes that didn't have to rely on wisps for players to find them. Instead, players could use their knowledge of Sonic's moveset and assessment of the level's layout to take risks, shave off time, and reward themselves with red rings. The shortcuts and alternate routes in Chemical Plant, Speed Highway, and City Escape immediately come to mind, but there are many examples throughout the game. To keep the game from getting stale, the pace of these levels were broken up by the return of Classic Sonic, the missions and character battles that were required to unlock each boss, and the bosses themselves. Classic Sonic may not be one-to-one with the Genesis games, and it is disappointing that you can't roll into a ball to gain speed, but his powerful spin dash and the return of the good old Badnik bounce keep his levels entertaining, alongside the design of the levels themselves. I suppose these levels make modern Sonic's 2D sections redundant, but I was still having fun in those. The missions are hit or miss, but I usually enjoy the twists and redesigns they give each level, as well as the callbacks to aspects of Sonic's history. The bosses and character battles can be pretty awesome, which is exceedingly rare for 3D Sonic. It probably has to do with the fact that they revisit memorable ones to save face, but the way they reinvented Sonic's race with Shadow and the fight with Perfect Chaos still bring me joy. It may not innovate on a whole lot, and the ranking system is pathetically easy to master in comparison to its predecessors, but this is still one of the most comfortably exciting 3D Sonic games of all time, and its extensive modding community has brought longevity to its gameplay. I could play this game for years and never get tired of it, which is a feeling so rare in 3D Sonic, and one that almost felt exclusive to the Genesis games for me. Unfortunately, there wasn't as much longevity to just safely emulating what worked in Sonic Unleashed, and they needed to ensure that the series wouldn't stagnate. Sonic Lost World was not what I think anyone had in mind. This game is such a fascinating beast, and it remains a complete outlier in the Sonic series as a whole. In many ways, it's just a traditional platforming experience that happens to feature Sonic the Hedgehog. Elements of his familiar gameplay from prior games are strewn about the levels, and certain zones can be pretty exhilarating once you've mastered the new infinite spin dash system and the parkour mechanics, but I want to shed light on why exactly this game was so polarizing. 9 years ago, I thought this game was pretty good, and I still enjoy aspects of it today, but it's pretty plain to see why it fumbles as a platformer when you compare it to something like Super Mario Galaxy or Donkey Kong Country, which were no doubt direct inspirations. For one thing, Mario and Donkey Kong may have different gameplay elements that transform the way you experience levels, but rarely did they fundamentally change how the main character plays between levels. And if they did, they adequately taught you the necessary skills through level design. Not only does Sonic Lost World ineffectively communicate complicated maneuvers like the spin dash and especially the parkour system, it also likes to switch up the way the game feels to play, constantly. The former is an issue because you have to pause the game and read the tutorial on the Wii U gamepad without any visual demonstration whatsoever. On PC, you might not even know to activate them. They expect you to know what to do when faced with a series of challenges based on simple, text-based explanations. It expects players to fly by the seat of their pants a lot of the time. As for the latter, the game is always changing the rules. Sonic Lost World is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're gonna get. 3D platformer, 2D platformer, mock speed section, slow-paced puzzle level, or some other random idea that can either be cool or infuriating. You're either biting into the gooey caramel center, or cutting your mouth open on a razor blade. The controls and physics also switch to accommodate each playstyle, which doesn't give the player time to acclimate to one single set of controls and physics. It's not like Mario and his one playstyle with several ways to apply it. This is a huge issue in any platformer as it is, and it's why I gave Sonic Adventure 2's structure such a hard time. Case in point, Tropical Coast, Zone 3. It's a rail-grinding level identical in nature to the minecart levels from Donkey Kong Country. It's pretty cool for what it is, but it doesn't appear again until hours later in the final level. Lava Mountain Zone 2 is one of the hardest levels in the game, and it comes out of seemingly nowhere. By this point, players could have completely forgotten how to control Sonic in this setting, and they've had no time to properly master it. This is the game's fatal flaw. Players are forced to adapt and survive so often that it feels like there is no time to master one thing. It also doesn't really help that fundamentally Sonic Lost World isn't very fun to play a lot of the time. Sonic takes another page out of Mario's playbook by having a run button. This can help in tighter platforming sections, but the platforming in this game kind of sucks. Sonic's mid-air distance is relative to his speed like in the adventure games, but when you jump, you have very little control over Sonic's trajectory. You can double jump to correct yourself, but this also sends Sonic in one direction to a certain extent. This lack of control had me begging to play Super Mario World instead. In concept, I don't particularly mind the streamlined traditional platforming experience that they went for in Sonic Lost World. I think it is possible to acclimate to the controls with enough practice, and I've been able to pull off some cool stuff in this game on occasion. It's just that the game actively fights against any possible opportunity to learn. While not an ideal entry, Sonic Lost World's missteps were not nearly as damaging as previous games. The series was not beyond saving. But in between this and Sonic Team's next game, the spin-off game Sonic Boom Rise of Lyric released for the Wii U. Although it would have just been a throwaway game at worst that most could have disregarded, it ended up being far worse than that. It was rushed by Sega to release for a console that could not handle the engine the team was using, forcing them to start over mid-development, and the end result is a dull game with some legendary flaws. The fact that Sonic has two games with programming oversights that allow for infinite jump glitches is perfectly representative of how depressing Sonic's legacy had become. Oh, and remember Chris Senn? Yeah, he worked on this game. I'm so sorry, man. In 2017, Sonic Mania released and became one of the most acclaimed Sonic games of all time, because Sega actually allowed fans to develop a follow-up to the classic games. After this, all eyes were on Sonic Team to live up to it, or at the very least compliment its positive reception. Instead, we received Sonic Forces, possibly one of the most painfully mediocre games I've ever played. I don't know if there's anything new I can add to the discussion of this game. Modern Sonic stages are heavily scripted and linear to the point where it feels like the game is basically playing itself. His levels are essentially corridors until they switch to 2D. All you really have to do here is hold down the X button and let the game take over. This was a problem in Sonic Colors, but Modern Sonic's gameplay is pitifully shallow throughout the bulk of the game's runtime. Red rings are usually just placed along the main path, with some being plain and easily discernible deviations from the straight lines the game lays out for you. Anytime a level seems to be picking up steam, it just ends. Classic Sonic is back for some reason, and he isn't nearly as fun to play with as he was in Generations. You can play as your very own original Sonic OC, but they are basically just Modern Sonic without the boost, instead utilizing various Wispin powers that provide slight differences in gameplay, though they aren't as creatively implemented as Sonic Colors' Wisps. The evolution of 3D Sonic came to a screeching halt with Sonic Forces. They didn't try to expand upon anything that worked before, instead playing it way too safe. All of the issues that had been simmering over the course of 3D Sonic's history boiled over in the most uneventful ways. I felt no ambition in Sonic Forces. It felt like it consulted a checklist based on elements that worked before. After this game, I had little interest in Sonic. Time and time again, Sonic Team had torn down any trust or faith that fans had been able to hold onto. Why bother caring? Well, those things frequently cross my mind. Maybe it's my nostalgic attachment to the Blue Blur that gives me a blind sense of hope for the future. But I like to think it's because I knew they were capable of delivering genius game design. They'd done it before, and those people still worked at the company. It just seemed like they were so afraid of failure that they'd either play it safe or abandon ideas entirely, even the ones that still held promise. Both the adventure and boost gameplay styles still had high potential, but neither gameplay style was ever fully realized. Again, they chose to start from scratch, and ended up settling on a new direction with Sonic Frontiers. The marketing for this game made it seem less than stellar at first. It appeared as if they were taking ideas that worked in individual games, and throwing them into a Sonic game because other games found success reinventing themselves, like The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, or Super Mario Odyssey. To some extent, that still rings true with the final product. But to my surprise, the game was actually pretty good. Sonic Frontiers features a few open-ended levels for players to explore in a non-linear fashion. You collect MacGuffins to free your friends, fight enemies and mini-bosses to collect gears that unlock cyberspace levels, and earn vault keys from those levels to collect Chaos Emeralds. After collecting all 7 emeralds, you fight the area boss and move on. You can find collectibles by completing platforming challenges akin to a Boost-era Sonic game, solving puzzles, or performing the Psy Loop in place for a while. In concept, this is such a breath of fresh air, and the biggest reinvention of what a Sonic game is capable of being since Sonic Adventure. There's a lot wrong with Sonic Frontiers in execution, of course. The puzzles are kindergarten-level fare that seldom take advantage of the fact that you are Sonic the Hedgehog, the gameplay loop doesn't really change much, the experience system and skill trees are rudimentary and uninspired, but at the very least give players reason to dig deeper into the world. Unless you go fishing with Big the Cat for about 15 minutes, and then you'll be topped off. Seriously, he can break this game's economy in half. There is an abundance of long 2D sections that you are forced to complete before you can break free and explore. The cyberspace levels were no doubt intended to serve as pace breakers, but they have vastly inferior movement in comparison to the older Boost games. And they reuse levels from previous 3D Sonic games constantly. Most of the S ranks and red rings are quite easy to obtain, with red rings often being handed to you in the same vein as Sonic Forces. That is, except for the S rank in Cyberspace 1-2. This level's S rank requires you to master the air boost and skip sections of the level by creatively chaining together jumps and boosts. It's some of the best boost gameplay in the entire series, and the S rank was no doubt a complete accident because virtually none of the S ranks are this hard to obtain. But considering Cyberspace's existence as a pace breaker, and the bonus vault keys you obtain for fulfilling each challenge at the end of a cyberspace level, it makes me wonder what could have been, had they designed levels around Sonic's movement here, and made S ranks harder to obtain. Despite all of these glaring issues that make the game difficult to recommend, I was having honest fun right until the very end of this game. I enjoyed the core platforming and Sonic's movement enough to keep exploring each island, I enjoyed platforming challenges that took you high up into the sky, and if you fell for whatever reason, you'd have to think fast with your abilities in order to recover. I loved chaining together homing attacks, boosts, and rails to access new portions of an island. I loved having to find my way over to specific portions of an island, or finding secret little nooks and crannies with tons of rewards. Because of the game's open-ended nature, there's even opportunities for emergent gameplay when trying to reach different areas. I thought the single-button combat, although simplistic in nature, was engaging as I tried to deal as much damage as possible and create opportunities and openings for me to attack. The game is a treat to run around in, and it serves as an example of what movement can do for an open-world game. Even if the tasks I'm accomplishing aren't always riveting, it's less about what I have to do, and more about how I'm doing them. And although the story didn't blow me out of the water, Ian Flynn's character dialogue reminds me of why I still feel attached to these characters after all these years. I also quite enjoyed collecting Eggman's logs, as they give a lot of depth to his budding father-daughter relationship with Sage that wouldn't have existed otherwise. The writing took me back to Gamma's campaign, which is something that I thought was lost to time, just as Gamma's heroics were. The bosses were easily a highlight for me. They are these amazing bits of spectacle where you have to take the combat moves you've learned and deal as much damage as possible as supersonic when you find an opening. Each boss seemed to be treated as if it were the final boss, which is ironic because the final boss is just Ikaruga. Either way, they were incredible, and the music took me by surprise. I guess Sonic Team went with post-hardcore music as the next step for Sonic's sound, and it takes me back to watching AMVs on YouTube in the 2000s. Do I love it? Hell yes. All of the vocal tracks, as well as the melancholic theme of building trust that permeates the entire game, both convey a message that Sonic Team wants to win people back and rise to the top once again. Sonic Frontiers was a massive, ambitious experiment, and despite its flaws, I will always respect it far more than I do the play-it-safe mentality that plagued Sonic throughout the 2010s. With that said, Sonic Team still has a long way to go. This foundation holds promise. If they're going to take inspiration from their contemporaries, they should instead study the philosophies of those games, rather than trying to awkwardly fit Sonic into them. Sonic Frontiers is the closest a Sonic game has ever come to emulating how I felt as a kid exploring the Mystic Ruins with Sonic's abilities, spin dash jumping off of cliffs and ledges to reach impossible places. There's so much potential here for the open zone setting they used in Frontiers, but the game never really takes full advantage of what was possible in Sonic before, especially when you notice the lack of any real momentum when running on hills. We're still not quite there yet. If all of the problems you solved were directly inspired by Sonic's moves like the moons in Super Mario Odyssey, or if, at the very least, they were a challenge to figure out in the same vein as Mario, and if they challenged your knowledge of those moves rather than scattering sequences of rails, springs, and homing attacks everywhere, we could have a Sonic game that reinvents the way we view 3D platforming. Is Sonic Team even capable of making a game like that? Well, roses are coming through the cracks, and I believe that Sonic Team is close to finding their flame once again. Rather than stopping short, they need to reach for the stars. They need to face their fears. I think Sonic Frontiers is emblematic of why I keep playing Sonic, even after being burned several times. Even though they've been knocked down so many times, Sonic Team has proven that they can get back up. Is that what I admire? Or does that just give me false hope for a game they aren't capable of making? Maybe, maybe not. But what I do know is they can't do it alone. If they want to rise to the top again, they need to hear our voices. We have to help them out. That said, it's hard for people to agree on a unified direction for the Sonic series. I once said that the Werehog has no place being in a Sonic game, but at this point, I don't even know what does. It's hard to define what makes a good Sonic game because so many people have different definitions of that. Is Sonic solely about the momentum you accrue from slopes and loops? Is it about maintaining speed or balancing speed with platforming and exploration? Is it about technique points and action links for higher ranks? Is it about what multiple characters bring to the table? what even is a Sonic game anymore? Well, if you want to narrow it down to one single element, it's about going fast. Moreover, it's about how speed can inform the design of each character and level, and how players make decisions. In doing so, they've been able to reward players both tangibly in-game, and by providing them with experiences that last a lifetime. Every 3D Sonic game had their own methods of attempting this, even if some were more successful than others. But even in the franchise's darkest days, there were always sparks of ingenious game design that reminded me of why I loved those classic Sonic games to begin with. And I think that's why I keep on playing. I think that's why I keep going, even when all hope seems to be lost. I still care because a part of me knows that things do eventually get better, even if it takes a long time. Even if there's anxiety over the dark parts returning one day after seeing the light once again. Even if there are times where I tire of waiting for things to improve and my trust in the future dwindles away. I keep going. And Sonic Team does too. It's alright to retreat to the past from time to time, but learning from the past is also key to a brighter future, and we won't get anywhere by playing it safe. I know deep down that the same people that brought me joy all those years ago are still capable of doing great things. It might seem silly, but all of this comes right back to why I still care about Sonic the Hedgehog. I've been Liam Triforce. Thank you for watching.